Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Hello, Dr. Rivers. Great to see you again.
Hi, thanks for being with me.
So you are a senior scholar in the Center for Health Security at Johns Hopkins. I'm the Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. And this is a special discussion for Public Health On Call, where we answer our readers' and our listeners' questions about the novel coronavirus and the COVID pandemic. Are you ready for some questions?
Let's do it.
Okay, here is a question. Are people who wear a face covering but have their nose exposed at higher risk for getting COVID?
It's better to keep both your nose and your mouth covered with the mask. That's really going to afford the highest protection both to you and the people around you. So I do recommend that the mask cover the entire lower face.
I see that Michigan has a mask up and mask right campaign right now to get people to cover both their nose and their mouth.
I think that's great. And I think that campaign also underscores the importance of a high quality mask. You want one that's tightly woven, and it's better if it's a couple layers. You don't want it to be hard to breathe, but it is better to have a thicker, more tightly woven mask than something loose and ill-fitting.
Got it. Then we got a question in about the people who have long-term symptoms with COVID. Do you know, and is it known, why certain people get those long-term symptoms? Is it because of their age or their underlying conditions?
This is not well understood, and I think it's going to be a big area of focus going forward. It's not necessarily linked to older age or underlying health conditions. People who are young and previously healthy can experience lingering sequelae or long-term lingering symptoms of COVID-19 infection. And I don't think it's really clear what the biological mechanism of that is, but it's clear that it is a problem. And it's going to be something we're going to have to be grappling with collectively long-term as we figure out how best to support and care for those people.
Got it. Here's a question someone wrote. Given how many cases of COVID are around in the United States right now, if I am at high risk of severe disease, should I be sheltering in place? What would you say to that person who wrote us?
We are in a particularly dangerous point in this pandemic. And so if you are at high risk of severe illness, it would be a good time to take those extra protective actions. I think sheltering in place is a good option if you have that available to you. You can order in groceries. You can do telemedicine. There's lots of opportunities these days to take extra steps to stay home. And now is a good time to really lean in on that.
So now's the time to call in some favors, in other words, to get people to bring you things if that's what you need.
I think so. We'll get to better times, maybe after January. I'm hoping it will start to improve, but for now, things are quite bad.
Okay, here's another question. If I've had COVID and my friends have had COVID, can we just get together for the holidays?
I wouldn't recommend it, no. We do think that after you recover, you are protected from reinfection. But we are, again, in a particularly bad place in the pandemic, and it is not the time to be taking risks or to kind of rely on things that we hope are true. Just stay home. We'll get together in the spring. Between now and then, I think, is the time to buckle down.
It's possible that one of the people could be reinfected and could actually potentially pass it on to somebody else nonetheless.
There's a lot you don't know. There's many ways that could go wrong, and I think now is, again, not a good time to chance it.
Not with the hospital so busy. So now we've got a whole bunch of questions about the vaccines.
I would like to actually ask these of you, Josh. I think this is much more in your wheelhouse, so I'm going to lob them your way.
All right, let's get started.
Why do the COVID-19 vaccines require two doses?
Well, they require two doses. They were studied that way because of the way that the second dose boosts the immune response so that people have a really strong immune response that can fight off infection of the actual coronavirus. Now, having said that, there is clearly some protection from the first shot. How much there is, though, isn't known, and there will be more research done to see whether one shot might be enough. But for now, the evidence is really about two shots.
And so what if someone is between the first dose and the second dose? How should they conduct themselves?
They have to be careful. People should always conduct themselves to be careful. But there's no question that there's pretty much the normal rate of vulnerability to COVID in that first week. It looks like there's a benefit after, I think, after 2 weeks of the first shot, you start to see some protection. But there's still that risk there. So I think people need to take care after they get vaccinated too.
And now if someone is planning on getting vaccinated, do both doses have to come from the same manufacturer? And how should people keep track of that? What if you receive one dose from one manufacturer and the second from the other?
So that's a good question. These vaccines were only studied where people got the same type of vaccine twice. So it is a good idea to get the same one twice in order to match up with where the evidence is. You know, those vaccines were 95% effective when they were studied that way. And so the best thing is to get the same shot twice. And you should ask about when you get the first shot, you know, how you're going to get your second shot. In general, these vaccination programs should be telling you at the first shot how you're going to get the second shot of the same kind of vaccine.
On that point, will people get to choose which vaccine they get, or you're just assigned and you get what you get?
At the moment, you know, when there are not that many doses at all, shipments are going to certain places. So some nursing homes, for example, may be getting one vaccine, the hospital may be getting another. So it's unlikely that people will be able to choose. I don't think right now there'll be vaccine programs where, you know, there are two coolers there. I think it's because of the scarcity. It's going to be one set of deliveries to a particular place. Now, over time, that may well change as the supply increases.
Now, as these vaccines are starting to roll out, I think there's a lot of curiosity about the side effects that people can expect. And maybe if you could talk also about more rare side effects and what we know about that.
Sure. So these vaccines were studied in very large trials. Tens of thousands of patients got the vaccines. And the side effects looked pretty manageable. Now, in general, a lot of people get a sore arm. People can also get a bit of a fever, maybe fatigue, headache, joint pains, but those tend to go away very quickly. Those are really signs that the immune system is responding to the vaccine and is going to be ready for the coronavirus. It's kind of like a sign that it's working. So people should be prepared for those kinds of side effects for a day or two, something like that. Now, they also look very intently for more severe side effects, and they did not find any that were related to vaccination. They are going to be tracking, though, a number of different things with vaccination because they're going from tens of thousands of people to millions of people. So it's possible that there'll be more information about side effects and potentially even some new, very rare side effects that do pop up. But I do think it's important to put this in the context of the alternative. The alternative of taking a vaccine is not just living your life. The alternative is being vulnerable to COVID. COVID has long-term effects, and I was asking you about them, the different problems people have with profound fatigue or their heart racing or they're not themselves. And so right now, we have a very strong safety record for these two vaccines in these clinical trials. And while there's some uncertainty, there's a lot of uncertainty and some reason to be worried about the long-term effects of getting COVID. That's the alternative you're judging against.
That's a really great point, and I think really helps to frame how people could think about these decisions. Now, the first vaccines are starting to roll out in most places to healthcare workers and people in long-term care facilities. But for the priority groups that come later, for example, people with underlying health conditions or older age, how can they who do they let know that they want to get vaccinated to make sure that they are able to receive it when it's time?
Well, I think it's really important in your area to be alert to the news about how the vaccine is rolling out. And that could be making sure that you're checking with your local health department, for example, or your physician who should know the right way to be getting updates. Eventually you'll hear, you know, maybe they'll say, we're going to set up a clinic at this spot, or these pharmacies have doses for people who meet these conditions. And you just want to be in a position to get that news so that you can go and be one of the first in line.
Now, we talked about how if you have recovered from COVID, it's probably still not the time to get together for the holidays. But what about a vaccine for people who have already recovered? Will it be the recommendation that they get vaccinated?
Well, I think the answer to that is yes, that people who have had COVID were in the clinical trials and are part of the recommendation for vaccination at this point. And the reason for that is that some of those people actually got COVID again in the studies. And the thought is that some people may have gotten COVID but not mounted that strong an immune response and may be susceptible, if not to severe illness, then to passing the virus on. And it's better for them to have a stronger immune response that you can get from vaccination. So that is at least the initial recommendation. We're going to learn a lot more about the effectiveness of the vaccine for different groups of people, including people who had been exposed before. And I think it's possible that there might be variations in that recommendation. But for right now, the safer thing to do and what would wound up being recommended is for people to get the vaccine. It is quite possible that vaccination is going to provoke a stronger immune response, more protection for the individual than getting sick, at least for people who had mild illness. But we don't know that for sure yet.
That's really helpful. Now, after people have been vaccinated, will they still have to wear a mask and social distance, or will those measures still be important?
So I think this is a question that you and I could probably discuss here. I think the most important thing for these types of measures is the amount of virus in the community. If there is still a lot of virus out there being passed around, then people probably are going to be asked to wear masks, keep socially distant in order to reduce the spread and prevent the chance that the virus comes into contact with someone who's vulnerable and could get quite sick. On the other hand, over time, as more people get vaccinated and as more people, you know, do take other precautions, the amount of virus is going to go down a lot. And when those rates go way down, I think that the restrictions on our behavior might change. What do you think, Dr. Rivers?
I fully agree. I would just add that one thing we don't understand fully about the vaccine yet is whether it protects against infection. We know for sure that they do a good job protecting against moderate and severe illness, but it's not really clear yet if people who get vaccinated are still able to transmit the virus to others.
So for that reason, if there's a lot of virus out there, it's a good idea to keep wearing a mask, even if you've been vaccinated.
That's right. And we will know the answer to that question, whether or not people who have been vaccinated are not going to be able to transmit to others. But while we figure that out, I think we'll have to still take a protective stance.
Great point.
How can we know the vaccines are safe, given how quickly they were developed?
Sure. Well, there are a couple things to really understand about this process. And I really appreciate that in the United States, the Food and Drug Administration has required the same huge clinical trial that it would otherwise require for a vaccine. We didn't do what some other countries did and approve it just based on some blood test results. We actually looked in tens of thousands of people to see whether or not it prevented the disease. So the size of the trials, the amount of data, it's the usual amount of data. One of the ways that it got sped up the process is that the taxpayers, you and me and everyone else, we put a lot of money in through this program that the that was run out of the White House, actually, in the development of the vaccines to allow companies to basically start each part of the process right from the beginning. So typically what would happen is the company might do one study, see whether it works. If it doesn't work, then they're done. If it does work, then they start planning the next phase. And if that phase works, then they start planning the next phase. Everything is A, then B, then C. But with the money that the taxpayers put forward, the companies were able to do A, B, and C all at once. So they started that first phase, and if that worked, they were right ready to get going on that second phase. If it wasn't going to work, they would have lost all the money preparing for the second phase, but it was just money. But what they gained was time. And so they were able to move from A to B to C so much quicker because they didn't have this period in between where they were assessing and deciding and figuring out what kind of investment to go for the next round. All that investment happened at the beginning, and that's all the way up to and including making the vaccine. Typically, you wouldn't try to make millions of doses of vaccine until you know whether it worked. But here, we paid to make the vaccine, not even knowing whether it worked. If the study showed that it didn't work, they would have just tossed it into the Atlantic Ocean or someplace like that.
One way I've heard it explained, which you just enumerated nicely, is that a lot of a clinical trial is usually like paperwork and enrolling people and waiting for the endpoints, but no expense was spared on compressing those administrative functions, but the data and the evidence was still full strength. Is that how you understand it?
I think that's true. Now, I think it's also true that we have 2 good months of safety data, and we don't know much after that 2 months. But as the FDA has explained, most adverse events happen well within those 2 months. So they feel very confident recommending it based on that. And of course, it's the compared to what? A ferocious pandemic, which can cause very severe lasting long-term effects for people.
Absolutely. Now, here's a question I haven't heard before. Do the COVID-19 vaccinations impact fertility in men and women?
There is no basis, I think, for believing that they impact fertility. I'm not aware of any data on that would suggest that to be the case. Of course, all things will be evaluated eventually, but this is a vaccine that has been described as a Snapchat message to the immune system, because it basically is some mRNA gets into the cells, triggers this immune response, and then it degrades, and then it's gone. So it's sort of a very temporary thing that gets into the body to help the immune system be able to recognize the coronavirus. So it would certainly not be anticipated to have any kind of long-term effect like that.
Now, last question here on my side. If someone has a loved one in a long-term care facility and that person is getting vaccinated soon, how will that change visitation? Will it be safer now to visit people who are in particularly vulnerable settings?
That's a great question. I think it may well change some of the policies. You know, places may be a little bit less likely to be on total lockdown, no visitors, if everyone's been vaccinated. That's a much higher degree of protection for people who live there. I think we'll have to see how those policies change. I would imagine there'll still be some precautions because of the various issues that we talked about before.
Well, I've had a lot of fun flipping the script here, so I will hand it back over to you for the moderator duties.
Okay, well, thanks so much, Dr. Rivers. It's been a pleasure. And everyone, you know, should know that if you do have questions for us at Public Health On Call, you can reach us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmond, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.